So this is the second episode of the Simulated Reality by Analytics India Magazine, and today we have Ankit Mehrotra, CEO of Dineout. I'm sure you would have heard of this startup, which is making the rounds. Ankit, tell us about the genesis of Dineout. What was the idea? What problem were you trying to solve?
Hi, first of all, thanks for having me here. It's a pleasure. We started off Dineout in 2012. Coincidentally, it was 29 February 2012 is when we started Dineout. And since then, it's been a crazy sort of journey. And what we started out to do and what we're doing today, you know, we never thought we'd be doing. But the idea was born from the fact that, you know, can we help restaurants manage a lot of their operations a lot better? And can we help consumers discover restaurants in a quick and an easy way? And that was when, that's the whole format. And the idea came to us. So I was in London, and I'd been in London since 2002, and I had been working as an investment banker. And I just got tired of, you know, doing that Monday in sort of, you know, nine, and I was literally working 14, 15 hour days. And I called Sahil, one of my school friends, and he was in the US at that point in time. And, you know, we'd been always discussing that we need to do something. And we just started discussing ideas. We loved going out. We used to visit a lot of restaurants in the UK or in London or in Sahel in Seattle. And whenever we used to come back to India, we realized that, you know, a platform like that doesn't exist which can help us sort of discover restaurants. So we're talking about like an open table sort of a platform. And then one day we both decided to just quit our jobs and move back to India to start Dineout. And this was late 2010 when we made that decision. And in 2011, both of us moved back to India. And since then, we've been on this, you know, crazy journey.
Yeah. So obviously, you thought there was an opportunity. But what was the eureka moment where you were like, yeah, I got something and this thing can actually blow up?
Yeah. So I think what happened was in 2010, November 2010, Open Table, which is the largest sort of a restaurant reservation platform in the world, was buying out Top Table, which was the UK equivalent.
Okay.
And it just so happened that we were one of the banks mandated on the deal. And when I was studying that entire model very closely, I realized that, you know, it's a great model that Open Table has built over the years, and Top Table also. So they were charging, so they had two revenue models at that point in time. One was they were charging a fixed fee per diner, and then they were also charging a software fee per restaurant. And that built a lot of stickiness. So that model just, you know, sort of blew me away at that point in time. And I realized, you know, maybe this is something that could work in India. And that was when we decided to sort of quit our jobs and move back. And when we moved back, we were joined by two more of our school friends, Sahil, Vivek and Nikhil. So actually all four of us have known each other since we were 5 years old. We went at the same school since nursery. Our parents were friends, and all of us had different careers up to that point in time. And then, so we left school in 2002, and we got together back in 2011 to start Dineout after having a career of, you know, 9-10 years independently. And then, you know, we just decided that's it, you know, it's time for us to sort of change the ecosystem per se, the restaurant ecosystem.
Yes. You know, in the food tech industry, we hear a lot about Swiggy, a lot about Zomato. There's a lot of hype there, I guess.
Correct.
So why don't we, hear a lot more about Dineout? I mean, in terms of how you're creating value for the industry, what is there? What's happening?
I think that's a great question. So I think, obviously, the quantum of funding that's gone into the business is also a direct proportion of the media or hype surrounding them. And having said that, we started in 2011, so we are one of the oldest food tech companies still in India who's out there and doing, you know, doing some business. So in fact, Zomato is the only one which was before us. Having said that, I think Zomato and Swiggy today are focusing a lot more on the delivery part of the food dining of the experience, of the restaurant experience. Whereas from day one, our focus has been on dining out. And that's how, as a platform, we've been able to sort of evolve over time. But more importantly, in our journey early on as well, we realized that the real value lies in sort of helping restaurateurs and restaurants manage their business a lot more effectively. And essentially, that's what we've been sort of building. And a lot of it is, you know, painful behind the work scenes that you have to do, you know, grind it out, working with partner restaurants. So while you know, there might not have been as much sort of, you know, media around us, but, you know, we built a very solid business, which is, you know, which is doing really well as of date.
Yeah. But how big is opportunity when you see, you know, in the food tech and, you know, the services around it? and you know the applications of technology which your company is working on. What kind of opportunity do you see there?
Sure. So let's look at opportunity from two different perspectives. Yeah. One is the consumer side and one is the restaurant side.
Okay.
So from a consumer perspective, you know, a lot of people are blown away by the fact that in India alone, at the top 20 cities, there are approximately 5 billion dining instances happening annually. So what I mean by that is that 5 billion covers are going to restaurants on an annual basis. Just think about that number, you know, how huge that is.
Mm.
And that includes if a consumer goes out, you know, 10 times in the year, so that's counted as 10.
Mm.
But he's going out and still spending money at a restaurant. From a restaurant perspective in India as of now, the latest NRAI report states that there are approximately 1.6 million restaurants, out of which 500,000 are in the organized space.
Mm.
So what we mean by that is that 500,000 restaurants are where, you know, a bill is being generated and provided to a consumer. So that's, so looking at from that perspective, it's a huge sort of from a consumer perspective as well as a restaurant perspective, it's a huge industry. And the dollar figure around this number, so another quick interesting fact about the restaurant industry.
Yeah, please.
It's 7 times larger than the Bollywood industry.
What? Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah. When we first got to know that number, we were blown away as well. So the average, so the Bollywood industry in India is approximately around 8,000 to 9,000 crores.
Yeah.
The restaurant industry is approximately 60,000 crores.
Whoa.
That's huge. It's the second largest employment sector in India. You know, crazy. Imagine, you know, that's the number of people working in the restaurant industry is absolutely phenomenal. Having said that, the other way to look at this number is that from a dining perspective, 80% of the industry is dining in at the restaurants, and only 20% of that is delivery.
Yeah.
So dining in or dining at the restaurant still constitutes a huge sort of a dollar value on that figure. So that's how big the opportunity is.
Yeah, I mean, and everyone is just like, especially the media is focused on the delivery part. What about the dining part? People are going and spending way more money to, you know, restaurants and, you know. In fact, when you deliver something, I think you're more conscious about the cost factor.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
you hit the nail on the head. So when we speak about consumer behavior, right?
Yeah.
A few things that and especially which is very India centric. So the fact is that in India, people today are dining out a lot more. And when we look at frequencies, it's the third highest frequency use case in India. So first is cabs. So people use cabs a lot. Then second is delivery, but it's not at the expense of dining out. And the third is food or dining out. From a perspective of what do people do? So an average Indian spends 20 times more on dining out than he does on entertainment.
Mm.
And that's purely because of a couple of factors, right? First, there are not that many options. You know, what does a consumer typically do today? They would go out to a mall, watch a movie, and then that also is ended by dining out.
Yeah.
So, you know, some of the studies that we've done show that an average consumer today in urban India is dining out at least 4 to 5 times a month.
Hmm.
And every time he dines out, an average bill amount is approximately 2,000 rupees as compared to, let's say, 300 rupees on a home delivery, you know, order.
Hmm.
So the ticket size is a lot higher. And even, you know, latest numbers say that an average Indian watches movie only, let's say, once in 2 months or something like that. And now with Netflix and all coming in, that's even reduced. So what I'm trying to get to is the fact that dining out is the number one use case for a urban, you know, millennial or an urban Indian today with a huge pocket spend. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's a huge opportunity. But at the same time, you know, the restaurant business is not easy. I mean, there are a lot of challenges. And so how do you think technology, you know, can help restaurant people, restaurant owners, you know, to solve these challenges?
Absolutely. I think,
If you can tell about that, you know.
Sure. So I think what's important to understand is the evolution of the Indian restaurant industry and how it's evolved over the last sort of 5-6 years.
Okay.
So essentially what's happened is that in the last 5-6 years, the cost of running a restaurant has gone up tremendously.
Yeah.
So for example, the cost of real estate has risen significantly. Cost of raw material, ingredients, food, etc. is rising.
Hmm.
Cost of labor has nearly tripled in the last sort of 6 odd years, primarily because of the advent of, you know, Ola and Uber from a cab or from a delivery perspective. So now people have an option. So earlier people were working in the restaurant industry, now have a lot more options. And as a result, the cost of running a restaurant has risen significantly, and the prices have not risen in line with it.
Okay.
And as a result, the profit margins of running a restaurant have sort of shrunk rapidly. And when that happens across any industry, people need to sort of adopt technologies to manage their costs a lot more efficiently and a lot more better. And this is what we are essentially trying to do at Dineout. So while Dineout is a consumer platform, and that's what it appears from the outside, and we see it close to 3.5-4 million diners a month, the meat of what we do is actually build technology for the restaurants.
Okay.
And we have a suite of, so InResto is our restaurant tech product. It's a suite of 10 different modules, and it's a SaaS module, and restaurants can choose to sort of pick and use whichever modules they want to sort of work with. And what we essentially do for the restaurant is a couple of things mainly. So the first challenge any restaurant faces today is that they do not recognize their customers.
Okay.
So what I mean by that is, you know, take an example of, let's say, a social or a big chain which has multiple outlets, right? I could be going to the same outlet, you know, 4 times a month, and still the 5th time I go, the restaurateur recognizing me is actually very sort of, if he recognizes me physically, that's it. You know, there's no way technology can be used to sort of recognize this the customer. And if I happen to go to the to a different outlet, there's no way that they would recognize me. The second challenge is that while a lot of people use pen and paper to start to recognize customers and write down registers, so you'll have a lot of restaurants with registers at the front desk where they're taking down your phone number, etc. The challenge lies that the POS or the billing system is actually a black box. So on the billing system, you would know that someone sitting on table number 5 just ended up ordering, you know, 5,000 rupees worth of food and drinks, but there's no idea who that person is. So typically a good restaurant, you know, is doing 1 crore of GMV a month, has no idea who its customers are. And once restaurants do not know who their customers are, they end up spending a lot of money on actually sort of acquiring the CAC. The CAC for a restaurant is rising tremendously, and they're spending the same amount of money on getting their new customers versus an existing customer. And that's what we are sort of, as a first step, we help restaurants do.
Sure. So apart from that, let's just talk about the technology aspect.
Absolutely.
Of it, right?
Because
what technologies then are you using? I mean, you mentioned SaaS products.
Yeah.
If you can just go, you know, and talk about specific technology products and how they are built from the ground up. Yeah.
Sure. So today, average restaurant uses technology in 3 different verticals. The first is they use technology to acquire a customer. Then they use technology to engage with a customer. And the third is they use technology to retain a customer. So let's talk about each of these in a bit of detail, right? So acquisition of a customer happens through multiple channels. It could be a restaurant's own channel where they have their own website or Facebook page or social media presence. Or it's a platform like Dineout or Swiggy or Zomato where, you know, where that's where the customers are and then they're visiting a restaurant. And these are the main sort of, or it's, you know, for example, advertisement and then direct customer acquisition that happens. So from that perspective, we help restaurants actually. So our first product that we use for them is called InResto Reserve. And or guest app, and that's the first thing that helps a customer to actually, when they walk into a restaurant, they give their phone number and get registered onto the database. So what we've done is we've replaced the pen and paper at the concierge, the front desk, with an Android tablet which is running a guest app, which is what we call, that's the name of the product, which is actually recording each and every single person visiting into the restaurant, and that goes into the database to do a lot more things on it. So that's how the first part of the system works.
Okay.
The second part, which or how restaurants use technology, is actually to engage with customers inside the restaurant. And think about every single thing that a restaurant or a consumer's experiences. You walk in, you have the menu, you have the waiters recommending dishes, you have people.
So recommending dishes based on my past order history maybe, right?
So this was, it doesn't happen today. What happens typically is that when you walk into a restaurant,
they don't know me.
They don't know you.
Yeah.
And then if you ask the waiter what's good, you know, they would recommend the top 2 or 3 dishes which they memorize or something. They're actually,
and I'm like, what if they knew what I actually like? Yeah.
Absolutely, exactly. And you know what's the funniest part about this is that when we looked at menus of restaurants, right? The average menu today has approximately 300 odd dishes across multiple categories. But the fact is that only 20% of those get ordered 80% of the time.
Okay.
But a restaurant has to sort of cater for all of them in the kitchen, and that leads to a lot of wastage, etc. And that's something that we're trying to sort of solve for them as well.
Yeah.
But from that perspective, you know, I'm just thinking about the consumer journey inside a restaurant. that you have the waiter experience, then the menus, then you have to pay the bill, then you have to sort of leave a review. So we've tried to digitize all of this using our system. Mm-hmm. And so, for example, we have in Resto feedback module, which is very popular with restaurants. And basically what it does is, if you think about it, right, typically what happens today when a customer has a bad experience, you have a sour experience, you leave the restaurant and then you go leave a review on a social media somewhere or some platform. But by then it's already too late for any action to be taken. And, you know, the restaurant has a bad name. So what we do is, in Resto Feedback is actually an Android tablet again, which instead of giving a physical feedback form, which typically, you know, people are not able to do any action upon, you're able to leave a review while you're inside the restaurant on that. And if it's a negative review, or we have some keywords attached. So there's a lot of intelligence and ML going into all of this. So if you are actually leaving a negative review, the system picks up a certain few keywords, and basis that it sends an alert to either the manager or the owner in real time. And it's possible to do service recovery while the consumer is inside the restaurant. And that goes a long way in ensuring that the end customer experience is really good, as opposed to them going and leaving a feedback online later on. So, you know, so that's one module that is done really well for us. We'll talk to the, we'll come to the menu in a bit. And then the third thing that consumers or restaurants interact with is on how do they retain or retain customers after the consumer has left the restaurant.
So that's also like a big pain point, I guess.
It's a huge pain point, you know, because today the problem is a typical restaurant is spending money on advertisement across multiple channels, whether it's social media, whether it's other platforms, whether it's print, radio, etc. But they have no idea of knowing whether a customer who's walking in is a new customer or existing customer through, and which channel is he coming through. So it's impossible to judge the efficacy of that customer.
Sure.
What we do very well is do great loyalty or campaign management for them. And essentially what that means is that once, if you remember, right, on the front end, now every customer walking into the restaurant is entered into the database, which is their database. Now, restaurants, we've given them the capability to run campaigns as and when they want across different criteria. So, for example, a lot of restaurants every morning, what they do is automatically people whose either anniversaries or birthdays are coming up in the next 10 days, they send out an automated campaign to them saying, hey, we know your birthday is coming up or anniversary is coming up. Why don't you come celebrate with us and get a 10% or 15% or XYZ offer? Now, the advantage of that is that it's a very customized thing. People are generally would generally go out to celebrate these occasions. And from a restaurant perspective, think about it, right? A restaurant who has 10,000 people and who sends an SMS to 10,000 people, the cost of sending that SMS is 10 or 12 paise. So he spent 1,200 rupees to reach out to 10,000 people. And out of that, even if we see a one, or typically we see a 1% conversion rate, 100 people would come back in using from that channel. And the 100 people would end up spending approximately, you know, 60, 70,000 rupees.
Yeah.
So the idea is that just calculate the ROI on that. You know, from a 1,200 rupee investment, they've been able to get a 70,000 rupee ROI. So that's very difficult or impossible for restaurants to recognize through other channels. So that the campaign or loyalty management is also one of our best-selling tools, which is being used by large chains across India. So overall, essentially, what I'm trying to say is, so that's happening on sort of managing the consumer part of it. But the larger challenge that restaurants face is on managing their backends and the and the POS or the billing system.
Sure.
So, for example, as I mentioned earlier, right, the billing system is a black box. It doesn't recognize who the person is sitting at the table. So, you know, we might go to a restaurant which we've gone to five times in the last 1 month, and we might end up spending, you know, 10,000 rupees, but the restaurant doesn't recognize me basis my spend.
Okay.
So what we've now done is we've integrated the guest app or the front end with the POS. And now what that means is that as soon as you walk into a restaurant, you would give your name and number, and they would seat you on a table number five. The same table number five on the POS would record you.
Okay.
And as a result, the whatever you're ordering, your eating habits, your preferences, etc., is getting recorded in the system. And as a result, it can be used the next time to target the consumer, or, you know, what does a waiter come and recommend to you can be done a lot more intelligently based on what you've ordered in the past.
Okay.
And that is actually being possible because now we also have our own POS, which is the point of sale system. And we built a lot on that. So this is all about inside the restaurant. But what about the back end, about the operations, about the ordering, etc.? So our best-selling module to date is something called the InResto Supply Chain. So which is used by all the top cloud kitchens in India. For example, InnerChef uses it, Fresh Menu uses it, CureFit uses it, Bowl Company uses it, Theo Brahma uses it. All the cloud kitchens sort of use this system. And essentially what they need to do is manage the ingredients that are coming in the central kitchen. And then from there, whatever is being produced needs to be sort of mapped to which outlet it's going. And as and when the outlet starts selling these things, it needs to get reduced from the overall stock so that once you're above or once you get to a certain threshold, you get the system can automatically sort of order the items themselves. So what we've done is we start with the front end of the restaurant and we started just working our way back inside to see where all can we build efficiency. And then the final point that we managed to get through from that is the actual logistics of the supply chain. So what we realized today is that a restaurant runs an operation very inefficiently because today they're dealing, an average restaurant deals with around 15 to 20 vendors for different kind of things. For example, raw material. You know, so he's getting rice from somewhere else, flour from somewhere else, meat from somewhere else, fresh vegetables from somewhere else, linens from somewhere else. But he needs all of these things to run operations effectively. So what we did is, and this was our latest integration, we actually integrated with Amazon B2B. And now a restaurant can actually go to our dashboard and at the click of a button, just order whatever he needs from and Amazon would fulfill that and send it to the restaurant. So the idea is we're trying to reduce friction as much as possible. Because typically what was happening when in our experience with restaurants was that you run out of, let's say you want to make biryani and you need rice and you need meat. You would get the rice, but you wouldn't get the meat for 2 days and then, you know, you're waiting for it. So now all of these things can be managed in a very seamless way by the restaurants.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very complicated supply chain, obviously, in the restaurant. I mean, your products are obviously very unique and innovative, but what about your backend? How do you manage all of this? If you can talk about that, you know, what is the tech that goes behind managing all of these restaurants and, you know, making sure that everything runs smoothly?
That's one of the things that we've done over a period of time is, done very smart acquisition. So in Resto that we spoke about, and actually the point of sale system billing or the billing system is also acquired. So we first We acquired in Resto in 2015. And since then, we've been able to scale it up to around 6,000-7,000 restaurants. And then we acquired Talkers last year in November 2018. And now we've been able to scale that up also to around 8,000 odd restaurants. And between the two, you know, there's a mix of technology that goes into sort of, building all of that. So now, for example, we're moving to the cloud POS completely. Okay. So Talkers is in the cloud now completely, and managing that in real time is a huge challenge. In Resto is a different language altogether. So now we're working very hard to sort of get all of this on the same platform. Multiple technologies are being used. We're always continuously sort of looking at, you know, where can we drive efficiency from? What's the latest sort of language that we can learn from a database perspective? And it's also complicated to understand because at a restaurant end, we're talking about, you know, multiple dishes, multiple ingredients, multiple points of information that is coming in from every single day that we're running operations. So how do we get all of these onto the same platform? And then how do we make sense of this? So we have now started doing a lot of data analytics on this, where using, you know, I know AI is used very loosely these days, but the fact is that we're actually running, you know, hundreds of thousands of touch points across restaurants, analyzing that and are able to sort of tell restaurant what goes with what, recommending what item with or combos with what dishes, etc. And that's actually brings us to our latest sort of product, which we launched sort of three months back, which we call In Resto Dine-In.
Okay.
And the idea behind Dine-In is very simple, right? When we looked at the entire restaurant industry and the hospitality sector overall, the question that we always asked ourselves was that how come that, let's say, flights or hotels or cabs have been disrupted by supply and demand and surge pricing, and why can that concept not exist in the restaurant industry? So for example, you know, last minute flights are expensive, last minute rooms are expensive, you know, cabs have surge pricing, but why can a restaurant which is packed on a Friday not offer a drink at 400 rupees and why does he need to offer the same thing on a Tuesday afternoon at 400 rupees when he's empty,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
So supply and demand has not impacted the restaurant industry till now. And the main reason for that was, when we looked at it, was menus. So menus, since the time restaurants have opened, have always been in the prescribed print format.
Okay.
And the reason for that is because it's costly to sort of reprint menus. It's very difficult to have differential pricing on menus, basis, analytics, or anything to do real time. And hence the industry sort of chose to go with the standard thing. And now, because we have so much information happening at the back end, what we are able to do very effectively and what we've done very effectively is digitize the entire menu and put it on the consumer's phone.
Hmm.
And it's not just through the Dineout app. Today, a lot of restaurants, so we're piloting this at around 50 odd restaurants. You walk into a restaurant and you have a QR code on every table, and every single person on that table just scans the QR code and you open the menu. And as a result of, and now once you have the menu on your phone, it's a digital, so, you know, we all believe that food, like a picture is worth 1,000 words. Okay. And it's nowhere more prevalent than the restaurant industry, where, you know, you have dishes which you just read and there's no way you can understand, you know, what you've read, what it would look like. And, you know, and the one thing that we noticed was that because of this, people went with the safer option always. So if I read a name of a dish that sounds vaguely familiar and I look at the two lines of description, people would tend to go with the safe thing because no one wants to have like a bad dish or a bad experience inside the restaurant.
No one wants to experiment and, you know, waste probably.
Exactly.
So
now what we've done is we've moved the menu to your phone and we made it digital and we made it pictorial.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, you can actually see what you're ordering.
Mm.
And what that has helped is that all of a sudden, people have now started ordering a lot more dishes, which they were not ordering earlier.
Okay.
From a restaurant's perspective, you know, typically they have to make provision for all dishes. So now those dishes are moving. Otherwise, there was a lot of wastage that was happening because they have to have the ingredients ready for a dish.
Okay.
But all these ingredients obviously have a shelf life. So that's happening. And then restaurants are able to push a lot more intelligence and combos inside. So let's say if I order a soup, I can push a dim sum to it. Or if I order a pizza, I can push a beer. And all of this is happening in a very personalized manner. So now, as I said earlier, right? Now, because we are analyzing so many data points from an overall aggregate level, but also on a consumer level, I know that what your tastes and preferences are. And hence, the system should be able to recommend something to you rather than a waiter would. And the system would be able to do it a lot more accurately and intelligently.
Okay.
So essentially what we're trying to do is, you know, just look inside the restaurant and figure out where all can we build efficiencies, where all can we sort of improve the consumer journey.
Yeah.
Just to give you an idea, one more thing that we're working with a very popular chain is when you typically, if you go out on a Friday night or a Saturday night, right, getting a drink at the bar is impossible. You know, there's a huge queue and typically you end up waiting 20-30 minutes.
Okay.
And it actually, no one thinks about it, but it leads to a loss of revenue for the restaurant. Because if five of you are going out and you're in the, you know, mood to have a good time, you want to have four or five, you're not counting your drinks at that point in time. But what hampers your experience is how long does it take you to order that drink? So typically, you know, someone goes, stands in the bar for 15-20 minutes and there is a, you know, rush there, people climbing over each other, I need a drink. And as a result, you could have probably had six drinks, but you ended up having only four drinks because of the time taken. The QR code works there as well. So what we now have doing is putting QR codes across the restaurant. You open it through your phone, you choose what you want, you pay for it, and then the bar, you just go and collect it.
Oh.
So you don't have to go wait. And as a result of that, you're able to order a lot more. So essentially, what we've done is the bartender typically is actually interacting with people, listening to what they want, and then making. Now he's just making drinks.
Mm.
It comes on a screen and he's making drinks. And as a result, he's able to make a lot more drinks and able to serve a lot more customers.
Which chain is that?
So we're not at the liberty to name it right now, but very.
No, it's for their own benefit. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure people
we're working,
want to go there.
Yeah. No, so we're doing it across a couple of chains. So social is where we're starting off with.
Okay.
We're starting with social in Delhi first, and then we'll scale that up.
Yeah. So the impact of your solution not only extends to restaurants and consumers, but also to people's evening plans. Maybe they don't have to wait.
Absolutely.
There's like queue management, right? Their mood is not spoiled for the evening, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah. So let's talk about your journey, okay?
Sure.
What, as a technologist, what made you interest? How did this passion come from, you know, for the food and optimizing, you know, supply chains in the food industry? Was it something that was there before you started out this this thing? Or is this something that you thought, okay, there is some value creation or like you want to make it more efficient?
Sure.
Or was there more passion about food?
No, so I think what happened was... by schooling. So I'm a computer and engineering graduate. But as soon as I finished my degree, I thought I don't want anything to do with the tech industry, and I went and joined investment banking. And I did that for 7 odd years in London. But food is something that all, you know, most Indians are very sort of passionate about, and I just realized. And so when we were looking at something to do, to start something up, and when we decided to choose the we chose the restaurant industry because we realized that it's a lot, not a lot of disruption has happened in that, and we believed that, you know, over the next few years that's going to change. But and that's how we got into it. But since then, it's been learning and discovering one step into the next. So we started off with a pure consumer platform. Then we, once we started talking to the restaurateurs, we realized, oh, okay, it's not just about sending them business. It's also about managing their operations. So when we, then we got into that. Once we got into that and we started looking at costs a lot more closely, we realized that, okay, it's not just about operations, managing operations effectively. It's also about reducing costs, etc. So I think one step led to the other over a period of time, and we just went sort of started to go deeper and deeper into this entire industry, and it just blew away our mind as to, you know, how much technology can help, but it's not helping them. And the, one of the main reasons for that is that unlike other big industries, like for example airline, you know, there are a few airlines, but it's a very large, each player is very large. Similar with hotel chains, you know, restaurants inherently are run typically by small, you know, not by individuals who probably would not focus a lot more on technology than they would do on a lot of other things. And that's where our focus became, right? How can we help them make life easier for them? And that was the whole idea of getting into this.
So as a technologist, obviously you didn't, you weren't interested originally, but then it came all back, and you connected the dots backwards, as Steve Jobs says. So as technologists, you know, what is, do you think that's important for a lot of technologists who, you know, maybe are not like interested, or maybe they are looking to do much bigger things than just being a technologist, and probably they should explore, look at these, you know, inefficiencies across different industries. What would you say?
I think it's a very personal sort of thing. Again, for me personally, I never, so me and Sahil both are engineers by profession, but we never did anything in that space. You know, we had careers in doing different things. But then once we started sort of, once we started Dineout and we started sort of evaluating and going deeper into it, we realized that the opportunities are endless, and technology can and actually does help change a lot of things for a business. So the idea is that it's all about exploring. Like, you know, as I said, 7 years back when we started, we had, we didn't have a clue that, you know, this is what we're going to be doing. We're not, I never thought we're going to be going deep into the supply chain and, you know, figuring out menus and, you know, building all of that. But I think one thing that's been always true for us is that we, whenever we've seen a problem, we've gone deeper into it rather than going and finding a new problem. And that's why for the last 7 years, our focus has been the restaurant industry, and we've gone really deep into it as compared to other players. And today we're one of the only platforms in India who's able to do the B2C and the B2B part effectively. And the, because of that, I think the solution that we provide to the restaurant industry is very unique.
And your acquisitions, you know, have been really, really valuable. They have added a lot of value. How, what is the strategy there, and how are you able to, because a lot of the times the acquisitions that companies make, they may not add as much value as they might think.
Absolutely.
So, but in your case, I mean, it's been very different. So what has been, you know, right? What have you done right?
So I think what we've focused upon over the last, you know, 7 years of our journey is finding the finding the right people who are trying to solve similar problems, but from a very different perspective. So we've done till date 4 different acquisitions. In Resto in 2015, that was the first acquisition. Then we did Gourmet Passport in 2018 February. Then we did Talkus in 2018 November. And then we did Binge Digital in 2019. And all four were actually solving a very particular problem for the industry. And you know, it's, I can say that very proudly, that the founders of all four companies that we acquired are still with us today, building and working towards building life, or making life a lot easier for the restaurant industry. And you know, we've, and it's just not that we are saying it, most restaurants that we work with recognize this, but also the restaurant body. So for example, you know, in August we had this huge industry-wide logout movement where people were, where restaurants were revolting against aggregators, etc. But we came out the most favorable from an NRAI perspective because of our tech focus and because of our focus on helping restaurants sort of improve operations. So it wasn't about just discounts, that we want discounts from restaurants. It was a lot more about how can we make life a lot easier or better for them. And that actually sort of, you know, that helped us receive a lot of good sort of word and coverage across the industry.
Give us an example of a challenge phase without maybe naming the restaurant, but you know, what challenge a particular restaurant might have faced and how, you know, you solved that.
Absolutely. I think that's a great question. And we've now done this across so many restaurants, but one example that stands out really clearly is this. So this is a large chain, which was very popular and it still exists today. Mm. It's got multiple outlets across multiple cities and same city as multiple outlets. Now, the challenge that they faced was that, and this is something that's very important to understand, and people outside the industry probably do not understand this, is that the key to profitability inside a restaurant is the table turnaround time.
Okay.
So what I mean by that is, see, inventory is finite. So you have 20 tables inside a restaurant and your dinner time is finite. You know, most people would dine from, let's say, 7:30 to 10:30. Now, the more people you seat on those tables, the more money you make. And that means that once you need to get people in and out of the restaurant very quickly. So if you, for example, if you can seat three different cover seatings on the table and you can somehow manage to do one more, that means you've increased your revenue by 25%. So what this restaurant, the challenge that they were facing was that they used to have a lot of waiting time outside the restaurant. Okay. So average consumer was waiting, you know, 15 to 20 minutes or maybe 30 minutes on weekends to get a table.
Hmm.
Now, what happens is that people don't generally like to wait. So they don't want to do something about it. But then once you get to a restaurant and you're waiting, in most likelihood, you'll go to the restaurant next door. And as a result, these people were losing a lot of customers who had come to visit them, but then end up going somewhere else because of the waiting time. They started using InResto.
Okay.
And one of the key insights that we were able to drive for them and show to them was, and these are very small things which are probably not that apparent, you know, sort of on the face of it, was that a lot of the tables were four tops. So what I mean by that is that most of the tables inside the restaurant were for four covers. But what was happening was that two or three covers were sitting on that. So there was always one chair or two chair empty on a table.
Hmm.
Now, after looking at this entire numbers across, you know, I think at that point in time, they had 30 odd outlets. Across 30 outlets, what we realized is that while there were people, you know, 30 people waiting outside the restaurant, there were probably 15 chairs empty inside the restaurant which were not being utilized because of the way they had configured their restaurant.
Okay.
And hence, we were able to conclusively go back to them and tell them that, you know, if you reduce from four top to two top, so basically just put two tables and if you like a table for two, and then if a larger group comes and you merge, it's easier to merge rather than divide, right?
Yeah.
So that would help them save a lot of time for the consumers waiting outside. And they did that, and effectively that 20-25 minutes came down to sort of 10 minutes on a weekend. And as a result, they were able to seat a lot more people and overall revenue increased. So that was one example that comes to mind, which sort of, you know, really sort of, you know, blew their mind away as well.
Yeah.
The second example that also is a very frequent use case is that typically if you go to a restaurant which has a lot of waiting and you want to go there, what happens is that you end up, let's say you arrive at a restaurant, you wait 20 minutes to get a table. It's fine. You're standing outside in the queue. Once you get the table, then you will get the menu at that point in time. You will decide what you want to eat. The waiter will come and take your order, place it in the kitchen. And by that time, you know, your first round of food comes, it's probably another 20 odd minutes. So from the time a consumer has arrived at the restaurant to the time he's first eaten or first bite of food approximately takes 40 to 45 minutes. And that means that everything else gets delayed. So what we did for this chain was that as soon as a consumer arrived at the restaurant, they registered themselves on InResto. And as soon as you give your phone number, a link goes to your phone with the menu. So you can start looking at the menu and you can actually you can order your first course or your starters or your appetizers while you're standing in the queue. And what that means is that as soon as you get a table, the kitchen has already started preparing your food. So instead of waiting 20 minutes to get food, you actually get it in sort of 5 or 10 minutes. And as a result of that, the restaurant is able to feed that consumer and have them out in a much shorter time, which means they can seat more people. And from a consumer's perspective, you don't have to wait 40, 50 minutes to order, you know, to get your first bite of food. And that's a great, that's a better consumer experience as well. So by doing this for this chain, we were able to completely sort of improve and increase their revenue per table for average meal time. So my point is that, you know, different restaurants have different needs and different use cases. So for example, nearly all of the iconic restaurants of Bangalore are using some of our technology, but the best use case is Toit. All, you know, most people in Bangalore have been to Toit, and it's crazy waiting. And they have a system at the front door where you have to enter your phone number. And that's our system. That's in Resto at Work, right? Yeah. That helps them manage a lot of things. So essentially, you know, our systems, the way they've been built over a period of time, is for different types of restaurants, and we fulfill different types of needs for those restaurants. So right from 5 stars using it to standalone outlets to large chains to QSRs to just delivery kitchens, they all use it. So for example, one of the use cases that we did not talk about was delivery.
Okay.
While we ourselves do not do delivery, what we realized is that a typical restaurant which is doing delivery is live on multiple platforms. So a typical restaurant is live on Uber Eats, is live on Swiggy, is live on Zomato. And the challenge that they were facing at that point in time was that, think about it, right? An order comes from a Swiggy or a Zomato. It lands on the Swiggy or Zomato dashboard. And from there, the restaurant has to manually print out a KOT and punch it into the POS. And he has to manage 3 different dashboards, training, etc. So we built a solution which we've integrated with Swiggy, Zomato, Uber Eats, everyone. And now instead of the order landing on the individual dashboard, it lands on our dashboard and it goes to the POS and then it prints the KOT. So we've been able to save a lot of the work effort involved for a restaurateur in actually managing multiple dashboards.
Yeah.
And you know, it's small things like that, this which we've learned over a period of time. After by being present in the industry, which has made life a lot easier for a lot of the restaurants.
Sure. What about like the, you know, your technology team? What kind of talent do you look for? You know, because our audience, you know, they are, a lot of them are learners. A lot of them are into the tech industry. So what kind of technology specialists or people that you look for? What are the
So we have 3 different tech teams as of today across 3 different locations. So we have in Delhi, we have a tech center in NCR, we have a tech center in Pune, and we have a tech center in Bangalore. And across these locations, they're working on different languages.
So
Java is big. We used to do a lot of work around sort of PHP, but that's not happening anymore. Moving to newer technologies, Python has become really interesting. We also have a lot of sort of automation going on from a QA perspective. That's really interesting things that are happening around there. So the idea is that the way we build our platforms and systems is that we're always looking for people, and the one thing that we look for more than language or technology is people who can come in and solve problems. And that's something that's really important, because as I said, you know, across the the challenges that we encounter, we need people with the mindset to solve problems, and that's what we are sort of looking at. This is not just in India, right? So our B2B technology over the last 1 year, we've been able to scale outside India as well across 5 different countries. So we're now restaurants in Bahrain, restaurants in Dubai, restaurants in Saudi Arabia, and restaurants in Kenya are also using our B2B platforms, because of the fact that what we essentially have done is that in Resto was the CRM part and Talkus was the POS part. And typically, one company was not making it. And as a result, what was happening was that the integration between the two was not really strong. So a typical restaurant was having to deal with someone else for CRM and someone else for POS. And they were not talking to each other. So the data flow was not happening. We've been able to, over the last 1 year, sort of build this together and integrate this tightly, so that the consumer journey starts from the time you walk into the restaurant, is tracked all the way till the time you pay the bill and walk out of the restaurant and leave a review. And with Dineout, it actually starts from discovery. So what we are now, to a very large extent, our vision was, and we've been able to build, is the fact that a consumer visits or discovers a restaurant on the Dineout app, walks into the restaurant and makes a reservation, walks into the restaurant, is recognized, he orders through his phone, he pays his bill through his phone, and he leaves a review and he walks out. To build this entire seamless journey. And the one thing that we did not speak about in this entire journey is payments.
Okay.
So over the last...
Because there are a lot of payment companies in India, right? A lot of fintech players and...
Correct.
So yeah, that's an interesting part. So yeah.
So that was more importantly a consumer play for us.
Okay.
So what we realized is that we had a lot of consumers who were coming onto the platform who were reserving a table and visiting a restaurant, but then they were dropping off there and we didn't know what they were doing. And if you think about it, right, reservation as a use case only served around 30% of the time when the consumer is going out. So when we looked at how can we sort of improve traction or stickiness with our consumers, we realized that every single meal a consumer needs to pay his bill. And what we effectively built was not a payment, like not a wallet ourselves, but what we've done is we've integrated all digital payment systems. So today you can walk into a restaurant and use the Dineout app to pay your restaurant bill. And you can use Paytm, you can use Phone Pay, you can use Google Pay, you can use Amazon, you can use credit card, net banking, you can use UPS. So you can use any and all forms of digital payment through the Dineout app itself. And that essentially means that a consumer doesn't have to sort of rely on multiple things. He knows there's one platform which allows him to use any digital payment mechanism. So he's now reserving a table through, or he's discovering a restaurant on Dineout and then he's going and making a payment on through Dineout, and that just improves a lot and that builds a lot of stickiness for a consumer. So today, you know, we have the largest network of restaurants where payments can be enabled digitally. As of last count, we are at around, I think, 19,000 restaurants across 20 cities where restaurant bills can be paid via the Dineout app. And, you know, we're looking to scale that up tremendously. So while on the B2B side, and that's the core essentially of what we're trying to do, right? Focus on the B2C part of the problem and the B2B part of the problem simultaneously, because at the end, we believe that both exist to make life easier, or we exist to make life easier for the restaurants.
Now, who would you categorize as a competitor in India? Is there like specific company who is probably doing the same thing? Probably Zomato Gold. Am I right on that?
So Zomato Gold would only be competing with us only on the one part of the problem, right?
Yes.
And that's the uniqueness about the platform that we've been able to build. And that's one of the reasons why we've been in this business and been able to survive for such a long time. Is the fact that when someone looks at the entire Dineout stack, which has the B2B and the B2C, we've been able to build a very defensible business. When we talk about the B2B, right, today approximately 10,000 odd restaurants are using some or the other of our B2B services, and we're scaling this up rapidly. Similarly, we have around 19,000 restaurants on Dineout Pay, we have around 14,000 restaurants on reservations, and essentially the ecosystem that we've been able to build itself is a very defensible ecosystem. But more importantly, we have people who are focusing on one part of the problem or the other. No one else is trying to do the entire thing, and that actually makes it very sort of, you know, defensible for us.
Sure. You, I mean, Times Internet is the one of the owners. So why is it not more efforts on marketing then? Like they should blow you up, right?
Yeah. So I think we've done a good enough job with it. Yeah. I wouldn't say, you know, it could have always, you know, with hindsight, things could have been better. But the fact is that one thing that we've always focused upon is driving value, you know, bang for the buck.
Yeah.
And over the last sort of five odd years, we've not spent a lot of money. So we've tried to build a business profitably and build a business sort of without giving or blowing up a lot of consumer money on consumers. So today, you know, even when you look at the top sort of e-commerce people or people in the food tech space, a lot of them are burning a lot of money on
marketing,
and on customer acquisition and retention.
Yes.
We don't do that.
Okay.
And as a result, probably that's the reason why. And you know, I think in a way that it's good that we've not had that sort of luxury to blow up a lot of money, because that way we've been able to focus on actually doing it the right way.
Yes.
And yeah, of course, you know, in hindsight, things could, you could have done more, you could have done less, but I think today we're very comfortable. I won't say comfortable because that means that we're lazy, but no. We're very happy with where we are, because now we have, as a platform, we've been growing tremendously over the last sort of, you know, 12 months. So this year, for example, without revealing numbers, we'll have nearly a 3x growth on revenue. We've had a 3.5x growth on the number of restaurants on the platform, number of restaurants using technology. So things are going really well for us as of now.
With so much of data, what are the other opportunities? What are you planning on newer kind of solutions? Because you have had integrated, you know, POS systems, CRM systems. Are you looking to solve, you know, more inefficiencies in the hotel supply chain?
Absolutely. So it's not just about supply chain, right?
Yeah.
What's important to understand is, you know, so we believe less is more.
Okay.
So now, again, where can we help restaurants?
Hmm.
So first, we're now getting into menu planning with them.
Okay.
So, you know, typically not every restaurant needs to plan 300 items on the menu.
I think Gordon Ramsay may be interested.
Yeah. No, and that's something that, you know, if you think about traditionally outside India, that's happening a lot. You know, typically restaurants, you know, have their entire menu on two pages and they just do what they're good at. As opposed to India, where, you know, in the last few years, it's all become sort of multi-cuisine restaurants with multiple sort of, you know, with hundreds of dishes. The idea is that doing less is equal to doing more. So we're helping restaurants get into menu planning, because typically in a restaurant, you know, or in an area, you know where what people are ordering or what they're going out for. You don't need to have everything.
Yeah.
You should focus on what you're good at. So that's one thing that we're doing. We're also working very closely with other associated company, FMCG companies, who are focusing on the restaurant industry to be able to push out their products a lot more now. For example, I know that, you know, in, let's say if you go to a pizza place, that you'll end up drinking, probably the likelihood of a consumer having beer is a lot higher than having, let's say, hard liquor.
Hmm.
So then can we work with beer companies to push beer at those outlets? And can we, so things like that are something that, through intelligence, we are able to sort of, scale up really well.
So more probably AI and automation part
Absolutely. And that's, I think that's something, because of the millions of data points that we're getting access to, just because we've now started to sort of use that effectively. And there's still so much to be done on this space.
Yeah. And, with data comes also the issue of privacy. You were mentioning, you know, that at a restaurant, users are asked for their phone numbers.
Yeah.
What if they're like, some users may not be interested in giving out their phone numbers? How do you manage data privacy in that?
So, see, what we believe is that the data that of a restaurant is their data. From that perspective, we consider ourselves to be like a data bank.
Okay.
So we never do cross promotions. I would never give one restaurant data to anyone. A restaurant can do anything that they want on their own data, but they cannot sort of use any other restaurant's data. And that's something that we've sort of, over the last, 5 years, been very sort of cognizant of.
Yeah.
And that's also the reason why today we have around 10,000 restaurants on the platform readily sharing the data with us, because we're not, you know, doing cross-selling or cross-promotion across databases. But having said that, yeah, we're always trying to, you know, figure out how can we make sort of data a lot more protected, and that's something that's an ongoing sort of process.
Okay, thank you so much for your time.
I think
those were some really, you know, great insights, and it was great to understand such deep aspects of the food tech industry, which are kind of hidden, you know, from the public eye. So thank you again for your time. Really appreciate it.
No, it's a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me over, and hopefully we look forward to seeing you guys use Dineout very soon.
Yeah, great. Yeah,
fantastic. Thanks. So, oof.